to frame where this all came from, when I started at Winning by Design, one of the things we do is we listen to calls. How many of you, just let me know if you want to raise your hand or throw in the chat, do you listen to your team's calls? Do you do call reviews? This is what, this, if you don't do it, let's see, does anyone do it? Oh my gosh, we got an absolutely and we got some no's. Okay. If you are not doing it, this is one of the most eye-opening things you can actually do with your team. So when I listen to a bunch of calls, one, you know, I heard some really, really great stuff, passion, you know, passionate people who were really quick to respond, answer it. Like this whole CSMs are, you know, full of, you know, getting it done. Once I think the title of my job was actually get it done, make it happen and keep everyone happy. That was really hard to fit on a business card, but that was my official title. So all this willingness to help, right? But one thing, when I listened to a lot of impact reviews or EBRs, one thing I heard was a lot of features. So it's one of the critical components of EBRs, and you'll understand a little bit more of why this is talking about new features or functionality that your company has come out with over the last period of time. And so, you know, quickly, how many of you, I'd love to know again in the chat, how many of you have a feature section as part of your EBRs? And if you're doing EBRs, people jump in, we do them, perfect. So I'll let everyone throw it in there and I'll talk a little bit about, so we hear a lot of features, and not a lot of why. Not a lot of understanding, why are you sharing this with me? So I get a lot of, and here's what we've introduced and here's what we've done. And we miss the context of why, as well as the impact that we are going to help you as a customer achieve through all of this new amazing functionality. Now, a really great way to transition from feature to impact is through telling a story of an existing customer that's using that. But it is very, very critical when you are sharing the amazing new functionality that your product team has worked so hard to release, is to make sure that you contextualize it in terms of impact. I do understand that sometimes you can't record calls. I saw someone throw that in there. It is definitely a challenging sometimes to record some of those calls. Sometimes you can just jump on and listen if you can get access to even just hearing what your CSMs are saying and making sure that they're responding accordingly is something. So we're going to talk about two main key themes today. The first one is the concept of sustainable growth. And so if you know about bamboo is one of the most sustainable plants that exists. It grows, you know, 2 to 5 times its size over the course of 3 years. That's incredible without using too much of our natural resources. There's been a shift in the world of high growth tech SaaS startups from this concept of grow at all costs, no matter what, to sustainable growth. So one of the ways to do that, and I'm going to show you how, is through investing more into customer success. That's how you create sustainable growth for your organization. The second thing we're going to talk about is the concept of first principles. Now we need, this is the foundation of this talk. And so when you think about first principles, who knows what I mean when I say first principles? You want to feel free to throw an example of a first principle in the chat if you know what I'm talking about. So first principle are things that we know to be true and they help us make decisions in the world. So a very good example of a first principle, and it's okay if you're wrong. So throw things in the chat. It helps me know that you're following along and where you're at. But gravity is a really great example of a first principle, right? So we know about gravity. We know that if we walk off a cliff, we are going to plummet to the ground. So we don't do that, right? We see a cliff and we say, okay, I'm going to stand a couple feet back. This is an example of a very fundamental first principle. Another really fun first principle that we have, that sort of changed in our world of basketball. Normally the first principle of basketball has been in the past, shoot as many 2-point shots as you possibly can. And that's how you're going to win the game, right? So you're going to hire really, really tall basketball players who have the right angle when they shoot to make it so you don't get blocked, right? And so this is game of 2-point shots. Well, then all of a sudden the Golden State Warriors brought on Steph Curry, who is, you know, famous for his 3-point shots. Still tall, not as tall. And he works from the outside of the perimeter. And he changed the game of the principles of basketball, proving that if you can sink enough 3-point shots, you are going to win. There's a lot of examples of it. So this is how a first principle can change. Now we're going to talk about some first principles of customer success. Before we do, now that you know what the concept of a first principle is, can you share with me a first principle either that you use in everyday life? And if you want to just cheat and use gravity, that's totally fine. Take that one, but I want to make sure you're still following. Or a first principle that you follow as being part of customer success. So what's one first principle that you follow? Anyone want to share? It's a hard concept. We're going through business outcomes become product. Business outcomes before product, right? So thinking about, you know, what's the result that we're trying to achieve? And then let's build to that. That's a great. If CS is not aligned with sales, CS will fail. That is a very good first principle. It's a concept around, you know, I think sales will also fail if it's not aligned with CS. So thanks for sharing that. Keep throwing that in there. I'd love to hear more. I save the chat and I read it all at the end and take some of those interesting components. These are some great ones. Thank you. Customer can fire anyone in the company. Fast response to customer needs and communication. That's interesting. I agree with that. But actually sometimes I would follow the not too fast response, because then you're training your customers to expect it. So, you know, sometimes that's a first principle that I wouldn't necessarily find. So thank you for sharing. Keep throwing them in. So the first principle we're going to talk about in the concept of driving profitability through customer success is that recurring revenue is the result of recurring impact. Let's figure out, let's dive deeper into this. So typically, the way we get to that hockey stick of growth, that goal, that revenue goal, is this focus on winning new logos, making them successful, you know, making sure that they don't leave us, and then making them love us, right? And then we continue to just win new logos, right? This focus on sales, this focus on, you know, filling that funnel and closing deals. And that's how you get to your target revenue. But what if there's another way? What if there's another path to get there? And it starts with successful customers and starts with after that, you know, after the close one deal. So we start with you win the customer and you help achieve impact together. And your customers, your existing customers, create that momentum and help you grow together. And that momentum happens through the outcome of recurring impact. And once your customers achieve that recurring impact, they're going to help you grow through growing themselves, right? Retention, and we're going to talk about how retention is the main source of profitability for your organization, but also through growing and buying new products and expanding to new areas of their organization through cross-sell, but upselling new features, and then also through referring you to other customers. Or when they leave, if you've helped them achieve so much impact with their job, they're going to bring you to their next company. So this concept of creating this momentum from customers creates this concept of customer-led growth versus sales-led growth. And this is a really important shift that we're starting to see with the most successful companies today, where you're starting to get your growth from those successful customers as opposed to just focusing on filling the funnel. The one of the amazing things with customer-led growth is you don't actually have to have this maniacal focus on both winning new logos, but also on churn. With customer-led growth, we focus on winning the right customers and making them successful. And if some customers aren't getting the right impact, we let them go because they aren't growing our ecosystem. And you end up just spending money to save them versus focusing on the other pieces. Let's talk about, we all are part of these recurring revenue companies. And if you think about, and if you look at this funnel, you have the top of the funnel and you have revenue, but where is this concept of recurring? Where is this in a sales funnel? So we flip our funnel on its side, and recurring revenue comes after the commit from creating recurring impact. And recurring revenue is the result of your customers achieving recurring impact. Does everyone know? Does anyone have any questions? This is like the foundational element of, you know, the first principle lays that foundation and we build upon that. So does anyone have any questions about this concept of recurring recurring revenue is the outcome of recurring impact? And I see Jeremy, you asked what companies have we seen achieve customer-led growth? Many companies we're seeing do this. Of course, as soon as I'm asked to name a bunch of companies, my mind often goes blank. But you think about any company, like Slack's a really great example of one. I mean, now they're a product-led growth company, but you know, the concept of increasing seats, having a great user experience, Zoom's another great example of this, right? Growing your existing customer base, adding new features and functionality, driving impact and value. So we have the front end of the funnel that we are so used to seeing, and then you have the back end of the funnel, and together they work to drive impact. So that way we can get that recurring revenue as the result of recurring impact. If you take away one thing, I want you to take away this concept of it's not a linear, it's not a funnel that sits, you know, that flows down. It is a bow tie, because so much of the revenue happens after that initial sale with recurring impact to create that recurring revenue model that we all are looking to achieve. Okay, so the right way to measure CS, and if it's based on recurring impact, the right way to measure CS is with impact and not through CSAT. So one very quick example. So I just want to know from you, how are you measuring your CS team today? What types of things are you using to measure them and to measure the success of your customers? Throw in the chat, please, what you're doing today. NRR is typically a very, number of renewals, net retention. We always hear net retention, which is great. Got some NPS. So here's something I want to try. And Matt, I see your mic is off. Would you be willing to do a little bit of a role play with me?
Why, of course.
Amazing. Matt, have we ever met before?
We met just via LinkedIn not too long ago.
So have I asked you, have we prepped this? That's like a magician. Have I prepared you for what's about to happen?
You have not.
Okay. Are you okay with this?
I am. Go for
it. Okay. Amazing. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to practice a little bit of a role play. This is something that I've done before, and I also recommend for a lot of our clients. This concept of asking very far out to the renewal, and you can do it in person, and you can also do it at scale. You can do it through a survey. This concept of, if your renewal was tomorrow, would you renew? So Matt, we're going to create a fictional character here. You are my customer. You are a fictional customer. I'm going to ask you this question, and I just want you to answer as naturally as you can. Try not to think too much about it. There's no right or wrong answer. You can literally go anyway. All right. Are you ready?
Okay.
Matt, thank you so much for being such a great customer. I just want to ask you, if your renewal was tomorrow, would you renew?
Yes.
That's amazing to hear.
Without a doubt.
What would make it even more impactful for you and your organization to make it like you scream off the rooftop so happy that you are renewing?
Sorry, I'm flipping between mute and unmute because I have some background noise. So
you're doing great. We're all in. Yeah, I'm sure everyone has a house full of kids, dogs, teenagers, wild animals. Who knows? But
you know what? If I knew that I could get some sort of longer term commitment and maybe a reduced service structure, I'd be like, I'm sold. Oh. And yes, let's make it happen now.
Amazing. Matt, thank you so much for sharing that with me. That is incredibly helpful. I want everyone to give a little bit of a round of applause for Matt. Thank you so much. You did fantastic. The first role play.
Thank you.
So what is something, let's play it again. What is something that you noticed about that? Anyone want to jump in? Who wants to notice when Matt responded? What did I ask? Anyone want to jump in the chat, or Matt, if you want to, anything that you noticed?
You look for his commitment.
Yeah. I looked for his commitment. And I also looked for what would make this even like, would secure it, would make it a slam dunk, right?
Yeah.
Now, if Matt had said no, I do want to call this out. If he said no, and I'm super appreciative you said yes, so thank you. We often will go to why, what's wrong, but I want to make sure that if you actually start to implement this, you focus on, we don't care about that. What we care about is what impact would you need to see in order to renew? And that focuses and gets the customer to think about what it is that this company can do and what they need to see to drive impact. Now, when I've implemented this in the past, I've had close to a 99% success rate. In fact, I've had, you know, even 100% success rate with customers who said yes or no, end up renewing. Because when you do this early enough, A, you have time to do something about it. B, you actually are, and this concept of asking about impact is really important because it roots it into something that they can tangibly use. It makes them think about, am I getting what I paid for, what I signed up for? And is it helping me grow my business? Is it helping me achieve my goals? And if not, how do we do that? It is such an effective way to actually gauge a version of customer satisfaction, but rooted in real metrics. Everyone was mentioning recurring revenue was one of the key ways that they measured their customer success team, but there's no way to actually predict that tangibly without asking some of these questions. And so often we do things like NPS, but there have been studies to show that you cannot correlate NPS to renewals. I am coming out with some documentation on NPS and the pitfalls around that. So look out for that to come, and we will talk about that further. So now we're going to move on to principle number three, that we think the model in CS and the ways you measure CS is additive, but it is in fact multiplicative. So how we think about this is we think customer success is a little bit of this box, right? You bring in customers. Customer success does this magical thing. And I love when there's non-CS executives in my workshops, because then they start to think, like, yeah, there is this, it is a bit of a black box. And then poof, lifetime value, right? But what happens inside this box? I want everyone to close your eyes for a second. Actually close your eyes. I can see you. I mean, imagine. Think about what that box is. What happens inside that box? Just think for a moment. And if you think about what your CSMs are doing on a daily basis, is there something consistent that they're doing inside that box? If you can throw in the chat something that you picture them doing, what happens inside that box, you can open your eyes, throw in the chat. I will share with you something that we see very often. This is basically what's happening inside the box. You have every single CSM doing things a little bit of their own way, not necessarily, having certain meetings, a customer calls and complains, that shifts our focus. Someone says they're not going to renew, that shifts our focus here. There's a product issue. We go this way. And every single day, every single day CSMs come to work and say, okay, what am I going to do today? What do I need to react to? And what we think happens is this concept of earning new revenue, and how we think about CS revenue is we earn new revenue from new customers. We add expansion revenue. We subtract what we've lost through churn metrics. Then we get to net new revenue number. So we're constantly measuring how many, how much, everything's this volume. We'll even measure love if we're doing NPS. And finally, we measure how much it's all going to cost us. But what if we're using the wrong model? We are using the wrong model. And this is why we get into the challenge we get into today, where we don't hit our numbers. And the first thing we do is cut CS headcount. and we asked to increase ratios. And I have a new workshop that we're going to go through at the end that's actually going to show the revenue impact of cutting your CS headcount and changing your ratios. We'll get to that shortly. So if we go back to that bow tie model and we look at the customer success funnel, there's three main functions. We onboard, impact and use, and we renew and grow. And each of those moments represents a conversion rate. So if you're ever familiar with sales and how they do their measurements, they often have metrics. They measure how many leads they get in from marketing, how many of those convert to a booked demo, how many demos get booked to another meeting that maybe a proposal is sent, how many customers who receive a proposal actually close. And you can actually multiply that and get to your conversion rates of every single one of those funnels. And we can understand, hey, if we increase our conversion rates, we can actually increase our revenue. Well, CS is very similar. We just often don't think about that. But what happens is behind the box of CS is we bring on the customers that we have and we multiply by the number of customers who successfully onboard. And then we multiply that again by the customers who successfully achieve impact by and renew. And we multiply that again by the number of periods by their expansion revenue. And finally, we continue to multiply that by the number of periods they stay with us, the number of times, the number of years or months that they continue to renew. So if we map that out on a grid, you can see if we just multiply one time, you get a really great linear growth model. But if you continue to do that by year one or month one, month two, month three, year four, you get this incredible hockey stick because of that exponential growth. And what's really, really cool about that is if we look at what lifetime value really is, it's our new MRR that sales is bringing in, times the combination of retention and upsell to the power of the number of periods that they're with us. And that's that exponential hockey stick. And something that is very, very obvious, but often not obvious, is this concept where so much of that is customer success. So much of that lifetime value revenue model is customer success, not sales. So now we've learned that customer success, the way to measure it through recurring impact and through a multiplicative model as opposed to additive. And now we get to our fourth principle. Customer success is the greatest way to drive profitability. And Jody, this is what you wanted me to get to. So pay attention. This is exactly the main takeaway. Okay, who knows in the chat? Who knows? Throw downs for me, please. In the chat, what your payback period is. So if you win a customer, how long does it take in months for you to earn back that revenue? Do you know? And if you know, how many months does it take? And I'll share with you the average in a moment. Jody, I'm super curious because you just said 1 month. What's the price point of your product? We got a few 6 months, 10 months. I don't know if you feel comfortable sharing, Jody, but I'm super curious about that. All right. We have got some very, very good metrics here on payback period. I did some research into this, and the way I've done my modeling is based on a 10-month payback period. So if for an average contract of 100,000, payback period is going to be, I modeled off of 10 months. New research has come out. It used to be somewhere between 10 months and sort of 12 to 14 months. New research has come out that it's more like 12 to 18 months. So we're starting to see that payback period creep up, but the model works nonetheless. You take the concept of, you know, what your average contract value is, your acquisition cost, your cost to serve, which is going to be about 20%. And that the cost to serve, I'm concluding just your customer success. And you are at a negative number for the first year. So if your customer churns after year one, you have lost money. That is not good, right? Now we look at year two. And in year two, we do not have our cost of acquiring. So we have our cost to serve. And we also have an upsell cost. So upsells can come in a few different ways. So I'd love to see if you can throw this in the chat. If you have an regular upsell, we can think of upsells in a few different ways. One, if you are a platform, think like a CRM or a marketing automation tool, you're a platform, it is very normal to see an upsell of about 6 to 8% every single year, because you are constantly investing in that product and enhancing it without charging extra for additional features and functions. So it is fully acceptable to increase that price year over year, which is why it's great to also lock, you know, as a customer, it's great to lock in for a few years because you get all the benefits of, you know, increased investment in the product without increased cost, but, you know, expanding that. So that's one way. You can also do it through features and functions, through adding more users or more seats like the Slack model. But generally we should be thinking about an annual upsell between 6 and 8%. So we add in this upsell and then you have a significant amount of profit in year two. Now, if you go to year three, all of a sudden your base price is $106,000. Your cost to serve is the same. You add another 6% on top of that and your profitability just keeps increasing every single year you keep that customer. Now, here's what gets really, really cool. Very often we save our upsells until the end of the contract. And so, or we don't even upsell at all, right? We just keep things the same. We work with a lot of customers who say, hey, we have a whole group of customers that have been with us for 6 years or 10 years, and we've never increased our prices. So they're paying us the same. So if we have about 20 customers, all paying about $100,000 a year, we have a book of business at about $2.5 million. And if they don't upsell at the end of the year, you know, at the end of 3 years, you know, this is what we're left with, right? Now, what happens if we upsell even just 4% with a 2% churn year over year? We start to see a small increase in our revenue, which will, as we just saw, will directly impact our profitability. But what if we start to do monthly upsells? So I took about a quarter of the business and said, if we monthly upsell them, again, 4%, what does that do to our revenue model? And what it does is creates an unbelievable exponential increase in your revenue after 3 years with that customer base. And this is something that is very often overlooked. And if we go back to that concept of when we do our EBRs and we talk about features, we often miss out on the opportunity to upsell our customers mid-contract. And it's a great way to drive such huge revenue and exponential growth for your company and profitability. So when we think about our CSMs talking about features and functions, we want them to position them as things that they can either upsell because it's, you know, prove that there's a reason for upselling based on just, you know, an increase in cost, or selling new features and functions. And sometimes it takes, as a CS leader, it takes you to help give product the heads up. Hey, you're baking all this really great stuff into our product. What about breaking some of that off and either paywalling it or creating as a new feature that we can sell? And that's something that you can, that you definitely should be doing. If your customers are getting huge impact from certain product features, breaking those off as new products that we can do as add-ons creates this opportunity for upsells throughout the contract. I'm going to pause here for a minute. Does anyone have any questions as we go through that? Things that we can sell, when to sell, how this works.
Hey, Julie, this is Manan here. Amen. Love this. Yeah, love this at the first place. Thinking through this, and I'm wondering how difficult it is for truly enterprise software companies. And there are multiple reasons for this. One is, generally we leverage renewal cycles as kind of the selling event. So selling outside of the cycle is kind of tough in two ways. One is alignment with the sales. And the second is aligned with the customer as well, whether they're willing to buy at that point in time or just wait until their set of budget comes in. Do you have any suggestions or ideas on how to tackle that sort of a conversation?
It can go a number of ways, right? And sometimes we are tied to a budget cycle, but sometimes that budget cycle isn't necessarily aligned with when the contract is, so we can get things earlier. So, you know, getting a customer to upsell sooner because of their budget cycles coming in. You could also do things like, hey, start using the product. Like you could even lock it in, right? Start using the product early and make sure that you, and it automatically roll into when we can do that renewal and locking into a longer renewal. You can do things like cross-selling in the enterprise, right? Finding new budget. You know, one of the, when I was at Fluidive, we often sold into customer marketing or a marketing budget, but one of our features was event-based. And so to get that other budget, we actually tapped into an event-based budget for that product add-on. And so that's a way that you can, in the enterprise, you know, other departments may benefit from these things and you can tap into that, some of that budget as well. In the enterprise though, like getting cross-sells, and we'll talk a little bit about, you know, how to do that actually right now and thinking about how to work in other business units. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the different types of meetings that we have. And so when we have, and we're going to, and this is going to feed into the account ratio piece that is really important. So the different meetings that we have with our customers, we often have monthly meetings, and the monthly meetings are, you know, things that, you know, we're going to talk about. And I want to make sure that if you're having monthly meetings, they are actually very purpose-driven. We don't want to have monthly check-ins because those turn into chit-chat sessions. And frankly, your CSMs just don't have time to do that. And neither does your customer. We want to talk about early adoption when a customer is new. We want to talk about change management if this is a product that requires change management. We want to talk about ongoing use and impact. And if decision makers change, all these different things, we want to be talking about making sure that the customer is achieving that impact. I would change monthly meetings to impact meetings, even if you want to, you know, make them really themed. Then we have quarterly meetings. These could be different themed EBRs around driving impact, renewals, expansion. And then we have, and this is very specific for the enterprise, we have biannual meetings. And these I like to think about as workshops. And we can do them in person, we can do them remote. And what we do with workshops is we have the ability to bring multiple people together across the organization to really highlight. And at this point, you take off your vendor hat and you put on the product expert or industry expert hat. Right? I work in marketing automation. I'm going to talk about how marketing automation can support your entire business, no matter what technology you're using, right? It doesn't matter the technology. I know marketing automation. I know advocacy. I know, you know, financial ops. I'm going to talk to you about data security. We're going to talk about that within your organization. And it allows you as the expert to bring in people from other areas of the organization to talk about, you know, collaboration and potential cross-sell opportunities, but it's not a selling activity. It's very much so a workshop style activity to bring in other people. And then we have the ad hoc meetings, and this is the most difficult piece and often the most disruptive to the customer journey because, well, they're ad hoc, right? You don't know when they're going to happen. They happen because of all these different triggers, right? Triggers such as there's a new decision maker or there's low usage or the main user is about to leave, or they could be positive too. They want to advocate for you. And we need to know, you know, those can take a significant amount of time away from your CSM to manage that. So when we do our modeling out of your account ratios, the important thing to do, and often we don't think about this, we think, oh, I need my CSMs to manage this much revenue, but we don't think about how much time they actually need to spend to manage an account. So at the enterprise level, 100,000 accounts plus, we do have all these different meetings. Now we need to prep for these meetings, right? So we need to prepare. We need to spend some time making sure that, you know, either prepare before, or with the case of ad hoc meetings, prepare after, meet with product, meet with support, whatever it may be. Then you actually have the meetings, and this is how many you approximately need per year. And this gives you a tally of the total number of meetings you're having per account per year. So it's about 70 hours per account. Now you have 2000 work hours in a year. You get about 70% that you can spend on client time. The rest is for internal stuff. And that leaves you 20 accounts at your max. Now I encourage you to do this for your customers because, and do this amongst the different segments. So when we did this, when I did a modeling out for accounts with an average contract value of $36,000 versus $100,000, I was able to take out, you know, we don't have as many meetings, we don't have as many monthly meetings. We don't have as many biannual meetings. We'll maybe do one. And you end up with about 20 hours spent per account per year, which means you can manage about 70 accounts in that category. If you want to be able to drive that personalized touch that we've defined as these are the important meetings we need to have. Okay. Are you ready to play a little bit of a game here? Multiple choice. What is the impact of a CSM managing 35 accounts versus two CSMs managing 35 accounts? The salary is going to be about $80,000 a year. And we're going to think about this as a book of business at about $100,000, you know, on the enterprise, right? So we saw in the enterprise that we want about 20 account, like a ratio for one CSM to 20 accounts. So, but we also know that sometimes we cut headcount or we just say, oh, hey, like just take on a few more. So what is the impact to the business? Is it going to be that salary, $80,000? Is it going to be more the amount of a contract, $100,000, $1 million, or $4 million? A, B, C, or D, what do you think? All right, we got a C, $1 million, D. All right, a bunch of C's and B's. I love we always see one person says something and everyone follows, which is great. So hopefully you're following here. I'm gonna break it down real quick. All right, so you have one person managing 20 accounts, it's $6.1 million. All right, you add someone that's 35 accounts. So now you have two people managing a book of business that's about $10.7 million. All right, now the business isn't doing so well. You fire that new CSM. What is the impact? All right, so if we look at 20 accounts and we look at, I've taken some average, you know, some average and some of our best practice churn, upsell, the number. So it's over a 3-year period. The LTV is going to be $306,000 when you have, you know, 20 accounts. We're at $6.1 million. All right. Now what we're going to do is we're going to increase the number of accounts per CSM. When we do this, as we continue to increase, because we're spending less time with them, that means our churn is going up and our upsell is going down. That means the number of periods they stay with us is going to go down. Now we know from the beginning that the number of periods they're with us is what determines that exponential growth. So all of a sudden our LTV starts to go down. So as we increase the number of accounts, our churn continues to increase and our upsells decline. If anyone wants to check my math, I did this as a future value in Excel. So you can monitor how I got to my revenue model. And this is what happens. You have 35 accounts before we had two people managing $10.7 million in revenue, when you factor in the increase in churn and the decrease in upsell and the decrease in number of periods, we could be looking at $6.7 million. So if you're seeing correctly, we have almost double the accounts, but we have barely any increase in revenue. So when we might think we're saving $80,000 a year, but the effect is actually a reduction in almost $4 million of revenue. So whoever guessed D, you are correct. So why does time spent by a CSM by account, what does it equal? It equals the ability for the customer success manager to spend the right amount of time delivering impact for your customer. Customers forget why they bought. They go off, usage drops, they're not getting value, they don't draw the connection to the original impact they were looking to achieve to what they actually are achieving. And that's forgotten. And they're missing out on it, or you miss out on a new decision maker and getting access to them. So if you load up a CSM with too many accounts, they aren't able to do the things that they need to do to make that account be successful. So it's not satisfaction. I actually don't even care about satisfaction. I care about impact. Are your customers achieving the impact they need in order to justify the spend and the investment of both time and money with your product? That's it. And they need help doing that, especially as you go up, right? Especially as every single loss has a greater burn, right? In the long tail or tech touch, when you're, you know, a couple $1,000s a year, yeah, we could lose 100 customers and not see that impact. So we want to mitigate that. We don't want to lose all of our customers, but there is that balance, right? We're not going to invest as heavily when there's not as much revenue to your business, but losing a $100,000 customer who has great upsell potential and great profitability if they stay with you year over year, we don't want to lose them. So investing in smaller account ratios means you're going to save those accounts. You're going to keep them for longer. Okay, so we've talked about some core principles. What we want to move to now is, what are we going to do about it? And that often gets to be an important thing, right? So how are we going to improve our performance? So what we're going to do is we're going to look at time, process and structure, and continuous improvement. Okay, so let's think about time. Who has time for meetings? No one has time for meetings. And I'm so appreciative of you all spending this hour with me today. But certainly decision makers do not have time to meet with you. Decision makers are often the ones who are most involved at the beginning of the sales cycle. So during the sales process, they get involved, they loop in the end user, and then very quickly, the end user becomes your point of contact and the decision maker stops being engaged. But when that decision maker is disengaged, when do we need to engage them? When do we often engage them? Renewal time, when something's not going right. That's a really crappy time to engage the decision maker. Hey, I haven't spoken to you in 8 months, but your usage is crap and I feel like you're not going to renew. We don't want to do that. What we want to do is keep them engaged. And how do we do that? Video. Video, who here is using video? We love video. Video is the best way. It's called to have asynchronous communication and keep decision makers engaged while respecting their time. There's so many different tools out there that can do that. I also learned about a really cool new tool to do scale your webinars. So when you think about how to do tech touch webinars and videos and learning and education, doing that at scale, but creating a personalized touch is so critical. So how does this work? So you have a meeting with an end user. You talk about some really key metrics that you're going to, success metrics that you're going to try and hit. Then you record a very short video. I'm thinking like 2 to 5 minutes max. And you call out the decision maker. Hi, decision maker. I just want to make sure, you know, I just had a great call with so-and-so. Here is what we discussed that we're going to try and achieve this quarter. Do you agree? That decision maker then can watch it on their own time. They're forced to stay engaged and they have the ability to say, that sounds good. Or, you know what? I just had a meeting with the executive team about these other three things and I'd love to incorporate that. You are keeping engaged with them. You're having them keep the pulse on what's going on without taking up too much of their time. Because what ends up happening is you book them in meetings and they don't show up. We don't want that to happen. The second thing is around process and structure. So what we want to do is think about, if you remember those key moments, onboard, impact, use, renew, and grow. We want to design a process to make your customer journey streamlined, proactive, predictable. We want to know what kind of meetings we need to have in order to drive impact. So what we do is we map out that customer journey across all the different phases. And then we map out those triggers, right? We talked about those triggers. What happens if usage is down or, you know, there's a lot of bugs or there's an advocacy opportunity or new users or decision makers? We want to map those out so they take the least amount of time to get back onto that journey. And then we want to measure it through health, through a health score. And that's the way to get to that process, predictability, and managing those ratios properly. So someone asked before, how do you know what the ratios should be? How do you know what meetings should be having? How do you know how much time should be spent? You map it out. And then we look to continuous improvement. So when we do continuous improvement, you want to provide your team, your CSMs with blueprints and a roadmap. How should I be having customer calls? How should I be telling stories? How should I be having impact reviews? And then we teach them, right? Let's review how, you know, review this concept of storytelling and being customer centric and taking notes and using the words that our customers use. And we want to role play and we want to practice. And we want to have that peer to peer. You saw with Matt, we did a role play, right? So we role play and then we get our CSMs to just do it, right? Get on the calls and do it. And then this is the most important thing. You have to coach them on it. So if you can't have, for some reason, you can't record calls, sit in on some calls. have CSM sit on calls and actually map out. We actually have bingo cards. That's like, did you start off by setting an end goal and confirming time? Did you ask impact questions and pain questions on your customer calls? And we have CSMs and managers who sit there with bingo stampers sit, so that way they can actually see, did they hit all the skills that they needed to do? Did they hit all those things that they need to talk about on this type of call? So we can effectively coach them on the specific skills they need to improve. And you continue to do that. And that's how you get continuous improvement. So if we go back to the five principles that we talked about today, we have recurring impact as a result of recurring revenue as a result of recurring impact. The right way to measure CS is with impact, not CSAT. I never see another NPS score. I would be happy. We think the model is additive to measure CS, but in fact, it's multiplicative. And if we understand that, we can see how customer success is the greatest way to drive profitability. And then in order to achieve that at perfection is by making small improvements to have a large impact. Thank you so much, everyone. I made it through 160 slides in 49 minutes with some really great interactivity. I really, really appreciate it. A couple of notes, and then I managed to actually save some time for more questions. This is a QR code to my LinkedIn. We share Winning by Design is an open model firm. So we share all of our content, all of our blueprints are available. We put a bunch of our videos and our teaching on YouTube. We put it all out there and we hope that you can learn from it and improve your organization. So, and we share a bunch of that on LinkedIn. So feel free to follow or connect with me. And I'd love to hear from you in the chat. Two things. So this is the second time I've done this workshop. I've made a few tweaks, but I've heard, from some other people that we want to talk a little bit more about tech touch. I'd love to know two things from you as you think about some questions that you might want to ask me. What is one takeaway that you've had from today? What's one thing you're going to take away and start implementing? And also, what do you want to hear about next time? And then if you have any questions, feel free to jump in. Virginia, you love the meeting review deliverable. So do you mean, are you talking about call reviews and doing the bingo card piece and coaching?
I'll come off mute. I love the idea of you schedule the calls with the client, your program manager, the end user comes, very much tactical. They don't want to think strategically. Your main point of contact, your decision maker is not there. But to re-engage them, you send like a really snazzy executive summary, maybe a recording. That might take a little bit of work over here where we are. But I just think that's such a great way to re-engage with the decision maker and sort of continue to kind of elevate with them. So I really love that.
Awesome. Let me know after if you have any questions about how to do this. It is hard. And we actually worked with we've done some work with BombBomb, which is one of the tools that we use for video. And one of the interesting things the first playbook we designed for them was onboarding. And when we looked at their onboarding, we looked at one of their key barriers to onboarding. It was that psychological aspect of getting people comfortable with video. So as part of the onboarding process, we actually designed some really fun milestones and we call them key moments, which was record, like as your CSM, I'm your coach. So, I want you to send me a video that can literally be you reciting a poem or just saying hi, because I want to give you feedback on your lighting and on your camera settings and your mic. So it's very technical. And then it's send a video to your mom or dad or your sister or your best friend, right? So making a very low adoption barrier. And then it's, let's start doing that. And they actually have really great, they share bloopers as a company organization because, inevitably we all have those bloopers. So those are some things that you can do to get people over that hump of using video. Okay, we got some more questions coming in here. And as they come in, please, please, please share some key takeaways from today. What do you do about refining and creating process for more bespoke triggers? So for technical implementation, so Felicia, if we think about, that process, look, all of this stuff, if we want to create it as a bit more scalable, the more bespoke we want to get, we have to spend the time investing into what needs to happen. So when we think about trigger plays, it's literally, okay, if this happens, or if we're trying to get this to happen, what are the steps that need to happen? Then who needs to do it? And then how do we do it? And mapping all that out And it should be a series of, you know, 3 to 8 steps and knowing who should be involved. And then if you can automate some of those, that's even, you know, that's even better. I hope that answers your question. If not, maybe we could get a bit more specific. Jack, what's the best time in the contract to ask for if the renewal was tomorrow? Okay, so as early as possible. So they need to have achieved some level of impact, ideally. So hopefully, this is important. We want onboarding. We want first value in onboarding to happen between 30 and 60 days. So that way on a 1-year contract, by the time 6 months comes along, they are starting to really achieve that impact. So for a 1-year contract, I really like doing it at the 6-month mark because it really gives you enough time to make some changes. If it's a longer contract, like 3 years, we want to start thinking about doing that at the 12-month to 9-month mark to their renewal again, so we can really make some core changes if something needs to happen. And the bow tie model, Praveen, the activate period, which is usually the initial 3 months, what is the best way to do a sales and CS and success handoff? Okay, so if you've seen any of the Winning by Design frameworks, we have a concept called SPICED. Now, SPICED stands for situation, pain, impact, critical event, decision-making process. Some of you may have heard of some of this stuff with regards to, like, if you ever use like medic or whatever. The concept is you use a framework, and we love SPICE because it's very customer centric, and we can use SPICE with customer meetings as well, with customer success. We use them in the, the handoff. We use it at the kickoff call. We use it at impact reviews. So the reason you purchased was this, you were trying to solve this pain and you were hoping to achieve this impact. And we keep building on it. So a great way to do a handoff is salesperson, log SPICED in your CRM. Maybe it's a quick meeting. Hey, what was the SPICED, right? What was the pain? What was the impact? What was the critical event that we're working towards? Who are the decision makers? Why do they buy? That's it, right? Very, very simple. Now we can have other details in there, but really important is what they're trying to achieve. Because if CS doesn't know that, then what are we working towards? Determining the headcount needs for CSM is helpful. I'm so happy to hear that, Matt. Thank you. What's your ideal utilization rate to ensure a CSM is making the ideal amount of impact before being stretched too thin and risking churn and lowering upsell opportunity? Great question. Okay, so you actually need to look at what's happening in your different segments of your customer base. Look at customers who are being successful and customers who are not, and start to understand what needs to happen. How much handholding do we need to do? And start digging into starting some things that we do when we go in and we start to do our diagnostic and we start to build out our playbooks is we look at the CSMs who have the best rate, the best metrics in terms of retention and upsell. And we start thinking about what it is that they're doing that on a consistent basis. And what is it that other CSMs aren't doing? And we start to log that and map that. And that's actually something that I encourage early startups that sometimes say, hey, can we engage Winning by Design for help? And I'm like, you're too early, but here's something you can do. Because if all companies did this at the beginning, they'd be so much easier to scale and grow. Map out those key moments. What are the key moments that the customer needs to achieve and to hit on throughout their journey with you in order to drive impact? Again, if we use that BombBomb example, if we thought about key moments, were getting over that psychological barrier of using video for communication. If we think about sometimes other key moments are getting some power users to realize how much using your product can impact their day-to-day and save them time, getting that one person to use it and then getting another person in their organization, sometimes that's a key moment. So it's both mapping out what your CSMs are doing who are really successful, but then also thinking about from the customer's perspective, what do they need to achieve and how do we support them in hitting those key moments? And again, often the key moments are going to be the same amongst all your segments, but how you support them in getting there is going to be different, right? You're going to need a lot more stakeholders at the enterprise level, which is why we have a lot more meetings and handholding. Whereas the SMB, it's often one person, maybe that person could be your decision maker as well. They're a lot more flexible. So we want to tack into those or hone in on those key moments, but not necessarily have them as meetings. Oh, thank you, Libby. Oh my gosh, your takeaways are amazing. Thank you so much for sharing. I really appreciate that. Thank you everyone so much for joining today. I really enjoyed meeting you. Thanks so much for your interactivity. Stay tuned on LinkedIn. I will be hosting some more workshops coming up. And if you have any topics you want me to cover, let me know. I'm working on some things around NPS and measuring your CS team at scale. So that's probably a good topic. And sayonara, have a great rest of the day.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Julie.
Thanks, Julie.
Thank you so much, everyone.